Hi, I'm Haley. I'm a product designer and aspiring Jeff Bezos. So right now I work at Square during the day and spend a lot of my time outside of work practicing playing jazz bass. And I'd like to talk to you today about what Jeff taught me about design. And many people in the past have tried to learn from jazz because there are just so many life lessons that can be learned from jazz. But and jazz, like lessons from jazz that like are universal and they're applicable to life in general, like this.
Solving problems, teamwork. You can use these in any form.
Yeah, but here I'd like to specifically talk about design and jazz because jazz and design are essentially the same. And I would like to walk you through why. Because first of all, the form is sacred, and this is what a standard traditional bebop jazz form looks like. And jazz standards usually come from vocal jazz, so it has a melody. And this is the chord changes of the songs, and this is Billie Holiday singing the melody.
There is no greater love than what I feel.
Yeah, and jazz musicians improvise on top of these changes. So I have Herbie Hancock's sick solo as an example. And these are the same too. And by following the form, jazz musicians can play with another and improvise together. So how important is the form? And I have Oscar Peterson, legendary jazz pianist, if you're not yet familiar, illustrating the importance of the form.
As you can realize, you're playing a tune, and you agree, it's sort of a pact that we're going to play the tune this way within certain confines. And, you know, if I were to go out, or you were to go out, and suddenly take a left turn on a one-way street, you know, it becomes a little hazardous in the group. And what you end up with is dishevelment.
Yeah, so essentially the form is an agreement between people that allows them to work together. And in design, the form is much less obvious, but we can find examples and similarities. And on the micro level, we have UI elements. These are Square's design system UI components. And this is what a search bar looks like. This is what a button looks like. This is what an input field looks like, and so on and so forth. And by having this shared expectation of what the shared components look like and behave, we can collaborate with other designers and engineers easily because we have this shared foundation. And we have the freedom to use these components and patterns in a way that fits our needs and goals. And we can be creative about what our shared form looks like and just like how there are different jazz standards. We also have brand guidelines. I brought RISD's brand visual identity, for example, because I'm a huge fan of this work. Brand guidelines have this shared baseline of what the logo looks like, what the typography, colors, and iconography looks like, and it lets designers improvise while maintaining this shared language and basis. So, but you can't break the shared foundation and call this an input field, make this a button, and use this to display critical warnings because you're breaking the pact and the basis of collaboration. And this is not just about collaboration within teams or organization. The form can also exist between designers and the users. So I have a few examples of creative tools. Here's Figma for 2D design, Spline for 3D, Framer for web, and Final Cut for video. And what they have in common is that the layers and navigation panels are on the left and the properties panels are on the right. And by adapting this common form, the user can immediately jump into these tools and know where to look and find things and what to do with it. And this is just one example, but when you break these kinds of expectations that people have, people become frustrated. And looking into jazz gives you insight into what a good form is. And in jazz, a good form can be both easy or complex. Some musicians like easy standards, some musicians prefer complex standards, but the ground rule is that it needs to be interesting and attractive to the player, and it should have ample room for the players to improvise. And I think this gives us a good insight into the relationships between design systems and designers, the relationship between brand guidelines and designers. And a great design system would be attractive and provide structure while leaving room for improvisation. And this might even be what a great software should behave, what maybe a good software should be attractive. And it may provide guardrails while allowing the user to mold it into their own style. And on the shared form, jazz musicians collaborate. And collaboration is fundamental in jazz, much like in our work. So typically in jazz, we'll have piano, drum, and bass, and sometimes there's a horn player or guitar player or a singer. And we'll typically start with playing the head or the melody, and then people would go around and take solos. And when the focus is on one player, the others focus on comping. And comping means accompanying or complementing. And the goal of comping is to make whoever's soloing sound good. So, for example, a sax solo can sound amazing when the band is playing the proper chords and rhythms under that solo. So, I have an example of the amazing Chicoria Trio and Kenny Garrett. And I'll play a little bit. And you can notice how the piano, bass, and drum players closely pay attention and adjust what they're playing based on what they're hearing from the sax player. And the rhythm section matches the sax player's energy and follows where he's trying to go with the solo. So every team or organization has different models of collaboration. And at Square, we apply what's called a DRI model. And DRI here means the directly responsible individual. And each step in the product development process has a DRI. And here are some of the roles. Just like a few examples of the roles that we collaborate with on a daily basis. Sometimes PM takes a DRI role and the others support them. Sometimes the engineers are DRIs and sometimes the designers are DRIs. And in order for the project to work well, the close attention and support from other roles is essential for the whole band to sound good. And the field of jazz is full of wisdom in terms of collaborating. Here's Thelonious Monk's 25 Tips for Musicians. And I highlighted the pieces that are related to playing with other people. Like this one, just because you're not a drummer doesn't mean you have to keep time. So keeping the time is everyone's responsibility. You make the drummer sound good, or you support your teammates to produce great work. Don't play the piano part. I'm playing that. Don't listen to me. I'm supposed to be accompanying you. And some wisdom on keeping the roles and swimming lanes clear. And yeah, it's how people collaborate and improvise together. So the next thing I want to talk about is improvising. And in our work, we designers improvise as well. We try our best to estimate and predict things, but nothing ever stays the same. We need to improvise and make changes on the fly. And jazz is all about improvising, really. And here's Ella Fitzgerald, who at the end of a great performance completely forgot the lyrics.
It's the magic night. Oh, what's the next chorus to this song now? This is the one now. I don't know.
Yeah, so she starts to improvise like nothing happened, and the band follows along. And it's so fun and delightful. And to me, this is the kind of thing that makes jazz so fun. And here's another story that I think about a lot. It's the story behind Keith Jarrett's Crown concert. And in this performance, there was some confusion backstage, and the only available piano was tiny and it was in terrible condition. It was weak in the bass register, and the pedals didn't work properly. And Keith Jarrett was also not feeling amazing. So when he saw this piano, he just refused to play and was about to leave, but he had to perform. So he worked with this bad piano. He mostly stayed on the middle range of the piano to compensate for the weak bass register. the pedals were working properly, so he would use more ostinatos and certain left-hand techniques. And the result is this haunting, ritualistic, and rhythmical performance. I'm just going to pick this up. This album is considered a landmark performance, the most famous improvised solo piano album, and a lot of people count this as the best performance in his career. So, jazz is unpredictable, stuff happens, and it's all part of what makes it unique and fun. And we get constraints, and it often makes us more creative. And also, being a designer means you listen a lot. You listen to your customers, you listen to your product, research, engineering partners, and build on top of their workflows and feedback, and listening to who and what's around you, accepting and making the best out of what you have is a wonderful skill for both jazz musicians and designers. But thinking on your feet and improvising doesn't mean you can just play anything without knowing what you're doing. And to be able to improvise and sound good, you have to have built incredible baseline skills. So I struggle to build these musical muscles and vocabulary. And from doing that, I learned ways to be better at design. So I want to share how jazz taught me ways to be better at design. And one of those ways is to learn from people who came before you. Jazz is so fundamentally rooted in learning from masters, listening to past masters. And here are just some of my favorite masters, and listening to them and learning from them not only help you build your musical vocabulary, but in a way they shape who you are, as told by pianist Benny Green.
Records that you enjoy listening to, that's like a reflection of what you dig and what you're about.
Yeah, and this is not just about jazz or music, learning about designers, designs, and art movements. Visual art movements that came before you helps you understand what you do as a designer. And I heard Virgil Abloh say this exact thing in the famous Harvard PhD lecture.
But just having a knowledge of what these different periods in art are can help you give understanding to what you're doing and why you arrive at these ideas, that they come, like the world evolved in this sort of way.
Yeah, and in the design world, it seems like developing taste is a hot topic at the moment. And I recently came across this article by brand designer Elizabeth Goodspeed. Collecting pieces of design history felt like an ethical way to bootstrap my taste level while I was still figuring out my own point of view. But as I looked at more old stuff, I realized I didn't actually like all of it. I started to tease out what spoke to me personally and what was simply old. And finding these traces of people across jazz and design, collecting, learning, and appreciating old masters and discovering their own voice along the way gave me a hint that the pathway to developing taste and discovering your voice is pretty universal. And if you want to learn from the people who came before you, you have to put in the work. And putting in practice is the heart of jazz. It's all jazz musicians do, whether you're a beginner or a master.
Practice the piano way over 100,000, who knows, 150,000 hours. And I still practice. I used to practice 2 hours of scales a day at the piano before I even played a song. I want to practice. Practicing. Anything I ever practice, just practice technical thing when you just practices at all.
Yeah, well, you get the idea. So, because nothing matters more in jazz than how good you sound. And this simple universal truth that you need to put in the work to be good at something is especially true in jazz. But the question is, how do you practice and how do you put in the work? And one thing that anyone will tell you to do to be better at playing jazz is transcribe. It's listening to a record, recreating it until you sound exactly like it. And this is me doing my homework. I'm transcribing the solo played by Paul Chambers. But doing this can help you with anything, like when you want to be better at prototyping. Like here's Robin Hood's card transition animation that I really like. So I tried to recreate it. And this is my recreation. And doing this is painful, and I've been working on this Paul Chambers transcriptions for months now. And it's one of the few proven ways to improve your skill set. And it's one of the most valuable lessons that jazz taught me, to be not afraid to look at something, find something that speaks to me and try to recreate it and learning from that. And it also taught me to detach my ego. Sometimes your work gets shredded in design crit, and sometimes you get your butt kicked when you're playing music with other people. But you have to detach your ego from your playing or your designs to get better at it. And I used to get super nervous in design crits early in my career because my self-worth was kind of attached to my work. But learning jazz has taught me to record myself, objectively perceive what I'm producing by listening back to it, base how I actually sound, and improve what I lack by like going down a grocery list. So no ego, no self-worth, just a simple grocery list. It also taught me to be kind to myself and pick myself back up when I feel like I sound terrible, which is pretty much all the time. And one of the lessons is to see things as unfamiliar and not difficult. And in this book I read, the author, who is a jazz pianist, talked about the jazz standards, All Things You Are, and asked why many musicians find this particular section to be hard. And it's because it's an E major, and that's a key that's not commonly played. And he asked, is one less talented in E major? Or are you less creative in E major? Is E major a harder key, or is it just less familiar? And identifying something difficult as something that you're not yet familiar with offers a simple solution to not make it difficult, which is you just familiarize yourself with it. And you can do this in everything. Like, you can do this in design. Sometimes you find something that you're not good at or something that you don't know yet. And instead of letting it frustrate you, you understand that you're just not familiar with it yet, and you familiarize yourself. And I found that to be really, really helpful whenever I face something that's challenging. And jazz also taught me to instill feelings into my work. And jazz is almost entirely about how it makes you feel. And we constantly ask ourselves what makes certain music feel the way it does. So, for example, what makes Bill Evans's playing feel so gut-wrenching? It could be the chord voicings, the spacing, the tone of sound, or all of the above, like everything that consists of what you hear. And I also ask myself, can I bring some of that feeling into my work? And can we evoke feelings with our work as well? And I have a Steve Jobs quote. I think part of what made the Macintosh great was that the people working on it were musicians and poets and artists and zoologists and historians who also happened to be the best computer scientists in the world. The point I'm trying to make here is that we should try to look outside of our industry that feels kind of bland sometimes and find what makes us feel something and bring that into our work. Like the orangutan, who took inspiration from evolutionary biology and aerodynamics. Nikola Tesla, who drew from poetry and Eastern philosophy. Dali, who took inspiration from quantum physics and psychoanalysis. So I want to leave with this. What inspires you? What makes you feel something? And can you bring that into your work? That's all, and thanks for tuning in. And please say hi.
Thank you very much, Eddie. Yeah, it was a really nice. I, to be honest with you, jazz is not something I'm super familiar with, so it was really interesting to kind of get that kind of side of it as well. And I think the lessons that you shared kind of almost apply to any industry, in terms of just being out there focusing on practice, not letting it get to you, and not tying your self-worth to your job. So thank you for sharing.
Yeah, thanks for having me.
So I guess, as I say, everyone, if you have any questions for Hayley, please do send them in. While we're waiting, just double check that there's no questions at the moment. What do you think is kind of the hardest part of detaching yourself? Because that's the one I've always struggled with. I know mentally, don't get your self-worth. It's they're commenting on the process, or they're commenting on the output. They're not commenting on your abilities, that kind of thing. What do you use to actually do that, though? Because it's easy to say, and I don't think it's as easy to put into practice.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm not sure if I have an answer to that. I think it's just with any mental restructuring, you just keep telling yourself that I'm getting better, and I think it's just takes practice and time of trying to perceive your work like it's someone else's. Like when you practice, everyone will tell you to record yourself and then listen back to it, because that way you're sort of detached to the moment you're playing, of your playing, and like the things that you feel when you're playing it. And you, like, when you're playing it, you sound like a master, and then you keep listening back to it, and then like the first few times you feel terrible because it sounds terrible, but if you keep doing it, you are able to just like objectively hear what you're hearing. And yeah, I think it just takes repetition, and I don't think there's a fast way around it.
Excellent. No, it's a great analogy. I think you mentioned as well, like, take a step back from your work and then see it again. And yeah, so many times I think that looks great, and you come back and you're like, oh, that does not look very good.
Yeah, you like when you try to face your work, and you just get used to this feeling of like, oof, that looks terrible. And then like over time, you just don't feel like it's you just get past that feeling of feeling terrible, because you're just used to it, and you're able to see this work and write down a grocery list of problems that you that needs to be addressed.
Brilliant. And just taking one step back, actually, to your, I think, I can't remember the word you used exactly. It was the one responsible individual or something like that.
Yeah, the directly responsible individual.
Directly responsible. How does that work in practice? As you were saying that it's quite different on each team. Is that a team decided thing, or is that a kind of, it just works organically with how people work together on a team?
Yeah, I think there is like a shared guideline or a shared model within the organization that says, here's the product development process. And during the development period, engineers are the DRIs. And during the solutioning period, the designers are the DRIs. It's more of a guideline. And in practice, it's just people don't really think about who the DRI is. But I just found that to be a good mental model to have when you're collaborating with other people.
And sorry, just as you described it there, does that approach of, I know it's not waterfall, but by saying somebody who happens to be the lead in that area, does that instill a little bit of waterfall style thinking? Because, okay, researchers own this, and then designer owns this, and then engineers own this. Is there a little danger of that?
Yeah. Now that you mention it, it feels like there could be that danger. But the way it's implemented, or the way we think about it, it's more about the responsibility of like who takes responsibility of this part going well. So everyone plays a part, but if you have to go to one person, that designated person is the directly responsible individual. It's more about accountability than who is doing the work, like who's doing the actual work.
That's great. No, it's just interesting. I'm always intrigued at how different companies tackle that very similar problem. So there's a festival on at the moment, if you can hear the fire. And yeah, I guess just onto your jazz career, what are your goals there? Are you taking this kind of full time, or not full time, but are you trying to break into the jazz scene?
Sort of. I approach it more like my goal is to sound good, and not like, oh, I want to play at this venue, or I want to play with these people. Like that would be great. Like I would like there are so many people that I want to play with, but my goal is to like in so and so years, I want to be able to sound as good as this person or I want to be at a level where I can like express myself freely, or I want to get to a level where I like hear my solo actually and like not be like, oh, that sounds terrible.
I'm sure you're too harsh on yourself.
It's like every jazz musician is harsh on themselves. That's just what I felt. It's like everyone says, people just say that, for example, I heard like my friend, like my friend's teacher, who's a jazz pianist, tell my friend that like, you sound corny, and that's what he hears all the time. And it's just that when you just accept that when you're starting out, you sound corny, and then your goal is to like sound less corny over time. It's just that like everyone just accepts and says like, oh, I need to practice, oh, I sound terrible. What's the, that's like accepting that, I think it's kind of healthy, because like everyone sounds terrible, everyone has a goal to like be better than themselves, like how they play yesterday.
I think that's a great analogy for everything in life. It's always just about getting better. So, Brent, I think that actually takes us to time. So I want to thank you very much once again, Haley, for sharing your amazing analogy. I hope everyone enjoyed it out there as much as I did.
Yeah, thanks so much for having me. I had fun.